let I'm with you. Be still and know I am.
Thank you. That was beautiful. That leads us into what we're talking about today. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. Good morning to everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning to any visitors. I don't see visitors today, so good morning to all of our good folks. This is the last Sunday in June, if you can believe that. Pastor Isaiah and his family are on vacation, well deserved. They'll be back next week. And next Sunday is also Communion Sunday. So we ask that you prepare your hearts and your minds for the celebration of the Lord's Supper. Today, our call to worship is a responsive call. And Greg will put it up on the screen for us. There we go. So please responsively read with me. The earth has its kings, but God is ruler of all.
Praise God above all, the giver of life.
The mountains may tremble and the oceans may roar.
But God's presence is more powerful than the earth itself.
Come into God's presence, for God is among us now.
O God, show us your glory. We seek your ways.
Come to the rock, the God of life, for God is present now. Please join me in prayer. God, you are our safe place to hide. You are our mighty fortress. You are our ever-present help in time of need. We can and do turn to you in the midst of our troubles. And Lord, our world is so full of troubles. In the aftermath of the building collapse in Miami, we pray for comfort for those families who are now holding out the hope that their loved ones are somehow still alive. We remember those today, such as the King and the Hornacek families, who are already standing at the graveside of someone they loved so dearly. We pray for those like Tina Athey, Scarlett's daughter, who have undergone recent serious and painful surgeries that will change their lives forever. And we pray for ourselves, because even as we declare our faith, we sometimes find ourselves doubting our very words. Lord, we may feel afraid because of all these things, but fear need not overcome us, because we know that we can put our trust in you. We experience your love and your grace like streams of water in the desert. Your joy, which comes to refresh and renew us, like rain coming down on the earth. Today, we ask that you bring your water of life to those in a dry and weary land who are mourning, in pain, or doubting. Lord, you are a mighty fortress, our refuge, our strong deliverer. In you, we put our trust and release ourselves into your hands. Amen. So please stand and continue worshiping in song.
Our help, our healer,
purpose of life to the one I love. I am drawing near with my hands held high. For I know that you satisfy, and the same grace that saved me is the same.
Next Sunday, we will be celebrating the sacrament of the Lord's Supper. Also next Sunday, live streaming of our worship on YouTube begins. The fellowship and Bible study will meet tomorrow night, June 28th at 7 p.m. MVC's virtual ministries meet during July via Zoom. The cancer support group meets as needed. If you are interested, please call Terry Dawson at the church office. The men's Bible study will meet next Saturday, July 3rd at 8:30 a.m., and the women's Bible study will meet Thursday evening, July 22nd at 7 p.m. And if you haven't already left your generous tithes and offerings in the basket out by the door to the sanctuary, you may mail checks to the church or give online on our tithe.ly site that you'll find on our Facebook page and website. And as always, please remember the Frederick Food Bank, especially in the summer months. And speaking of our website, please check it out. We converted to our brand new website a couple of weeks ago. And now, let's return to worship.
Thank you. I do move that myself once in a while, but Chris was very kind to say he'd do it for me this morning. I think we got chopped off at the beginning of the announcements, and I just want to make sure that we acknowledge and congratulate Rich Herbison for a unanimous vote from our congregation last week to be our next elder here at MVC. We're checking in with Rich as terms of a good date, perhaps in July on a Sunday, to ordain and install you. So, congratulations. Our scripture today is quite a familiar one. It is Psalm 46. God is our refuge and our strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth should change and though the mountains shake in the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam, though the mountains tremble with its tumult. There is a river whose streams make glad the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High. God is in the midst of that city. It shall not be moved. God will help it when morning dawns. The nations are in uproar. The kingdoms totter. He utters his voice, and the earth melts. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord. See what desolations he has brought on the earth. He makes wars cease to the end of the earth. He breaks the bow and he shatters the spear. He burns the shields with fire. Be still and know that I am God. I am exalted among the nations. I am exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Please pray. Our God, may the thoughts, the words, and our reflections that we share here today be acceptable in your sight. Amen. I went to college in one of our Reformed Church colleges, Central College in Pella, Iowa. Now, one of the attractions of Central and its programs was the opportunity to study abroad. During the years that I was there, Central had programs that were based in Paris, London, Madrid, and Vienna. And years later, now, they have expanded these programs to Wales, Brazil, and probably some other countries that I don't even know about. Now, I took advantage of Central's Year Abroad program in Spain. And this proved to be a particularly rich experience because it included living for a month at a time in four different cities, well, except for Madrid, where we were there for the whole rest of the year. But in the summer, we went to three different cities in three different parts of Spain. So we got to see four very diverse regions of that country. Now, the first of these cities was called Santiago de Compostela. Santiago lies in the far northwestern corner of Spain in an area called Galicia. Medieval legend has it that St. James, the apostle of Jesus, evangelized that area and that his remains were found there in the early 800s. To honor the site, a beautiful Romanesque cathedral was erected during the Middle Ages. I think Greg has a picture of that up on the screen. A beautiful plaza right here in front where you can see. And some of the cathedral has been since then renovated, but this is pretty much the original Romanesque architecture. Now, the next picture I took of myself, this, although it's a bit fuzzy because it we transferred it, believe it or not, from a slide, one of those things that we used to have, a slide, into this. And what was beautiful about this, not only was I there to see it, but what they do during every July is they have a festival for St. James, and they literally build a complete wooden structure, a facade, in front of the cathedral that is covered with lights. So at night, that's what you see, is the front of the cathedral covered in lights. It's absolutely beautiful. So each year, thousands of pilgrims, or peregrinos, make the almost 500-mile trek from the far eastern border, either here or here, far western border, sorry, of France, and they make the walk all the way across Spain to the culmination point of Santiago, which is right there. So it's quite an undertaking. So the cathedral is now known, and it's famous as the end point of that journey, called the Way of St. James, or the Camino, which is what we'll refer to it as, which is a Spanish word for road, journey, or pathway. Now, the destination of a pilgrimage is a journey, often to a foreign country, in search of new or expanded meaning about one's self or God. For this reason, I've always wanted to go back and walk the Camino, but have just never quite gotten there. But author Jean Rupp did. Miss Rupp is a lay member of the Catholic Servite community, and in a book entitled Walk in a Relaxed Manner, kind of a fun little title, Life Lessons from the Camino, she chronicles her experiences as she embarked on this walk of a lifetime. She writes of her mental preparation for the Camino, long hours of planning in her California home, mountains of reading material, and intentional reflection and prayer. She describes the physical demands of trekking long distances over rough Spanish terrain in both heat and cold, carrying a heavy backpack and tending to aching muscles and painful bleeding blisters. And the emotions that she experienced during her pilgrimage, fear of failure, exhaustion from the sheer effort of covering more than 20 miles a day, frustration when things did not go according to her expectations, anxiety over finding nightly accommodation, and then shock or even disgust at the lack of cleanliness in those nightly way stations, which were called refugios. Now, refugio is a Spanish word for refuge or shelter. It's also the word applied to the nightly accommodations that all Camino walkers must rely on. We probably would call them hostels. There are no reserved hotels along the way, no bed and breakfasts to welcome weary pilgrims, but only these refugios. They're few and far between. They offer a limited number of beds, and they are reportedly in varied states of cleanliness. So you can imagine. Miss Rupp admits that the effort to reach a refugio for the night was a great anxiety raiser for her. At 60 years old, she would watch in anguish as pilgrim after younger pilgrim raced past her at a faster pace than she was able to muster. And this, in turn, would lead her to worry that she might be the last person to arrive at that night's refugio, to either be turned away or to be assigned an unsavory top bunk with a lumpy, stained mattress, or no pillow. But as Rupp continues to contemplate these thoughts and her subsequent actions, she comes to realize that not only is she worried about a bed for the night, but she's actually competing with her fellow pilgrims for that daily goal. She was comparing herself to others and feeling dissatisfied when she did not measure up to their abilities or accomplishments. She comes to realize that she brought this competitive, self-absorbed perspective along for the ride on what was meant to be a slow-paced, contemplative, nurturing walk with God. In the end, she admits that, although there were a few near misses regarding a roof over her head at night, she was never really left out in the cold. In fact, on one particularly memorable occasion, when the local refugio was filled, a friendly villager offered her accommodation in her own home. She found that that was the most comfortable night of her pilgrimage. Further, once our author recognized that her worries were unwarranted, she found that she was able to relax and enjoy the now. She felt more peaceful, both, as she put it, inside and out. She was able to have conversations with her fellow pilgrims as they walked along at a more reasonable pace. She allowed herself time to stop and rest under the shade of famous oak trees that had grown alongside the Camino for thousands of years. And she pondered the beauty of star-filled morning skies as she rose early to take advantage of the cooler hours of the day. Of her experience, Miss Rupp concludes, "Overachievement, competition, comparison, addiction to work and duty, unreal expectations of needing to do more, the obsessive pursuit of having more, all of these fall on us as heavy cultural and self-imposed burdens. When these attitudes and messages press in on us, they cause us to lose our harmony and our self-satisfaction." So what does this all have to do with Psalms 46? Well, the book of Psalms reminds us that human strivings fail unless we rely not on ourselves, but on God as our refuge, our refugio. The Hebrew word for refuge, masa, is introduced early in the Psalms. Psalm 2, verse 12, says, "Happy are all who take refuge in God." And this same word, refuge, is repeated 23 more times in the first 72 Psalms. This repetition assures us that God is trustworthy. Today, we are looking at Psalm 46. Martin Luther used it as the basis for his very familiar hymn, which we sang earlier in our service, "A Mighty Fortress Is Our God." Psalm 46 is written in three sections, verses 1 to 3, 4 to 7, and 8 to 11. The psalmist uses these sections to proclaim that God's promise of refuge and protection is unlimited, not simply limited to the past or to the present or to the future. But God's strength and power have ruled from the beginning of time, are with us today, and will be the foundation for the eventual ushering in of his eternal kingdom over all. Now, the very first verse of section one, okay, Greg, thank you very much. Greg has it up on the screen for us. The very first verse declares that God is our refuge and our strength. And in this verse, the way the original Hebrew was written emphasizes that God's strength is not to be used against us, which many pagan gods that the people had in those days did use their strength against their people. But that God's strength is for us. God is our refuge and strength. The remainder of verse 1 confirms that God is trustworthy and strong, an ever-present help in trouble. God does not stand at a distance watching us, but is with us in our anxieties, our worries, and our distress, helping us even as we go through them. Jesus did not want us to worry. He told us in Matthew 6, "Therefore, I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or what you will drink, or about your body, what you will wear, but seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well." Seek first the strength that God offers you in your daily struggles, and he will provide you refuge in him. Rather than relying on yourself with your human ego, fears, frustrations, competitiveness, and unrealistic expectations. Verses 2 to 3 of Psalm 46 are based on the ancient belief that the world was a three-layered universe, with watery chaos above and below the solid land. Now, the mountains were seen as pillars that were rooted in the watery chaos below and held up the watery chaos of the dome over the sky, or the dome of the sky. And hence, as the psalmist writes, if this structure were to change and the mountains were to shake in the heart of the sea, the ancients feared that the land could collapse and that waters would engulf them both from above and from below. But even then, the psalmist can declare, "But we will not fear, because of the faithfulness and the strength of the God who is for us and with us." Now, the focus of section 2, verses 4 through 7, shifts from God's ownership of creation to God's control of history and all of the nations. The roar of waters foaming that we read in verses 1 to 3 now become the uproar of nations in battle. The shaking of mountains falling into the sea translates into the toppling of earthly kingdoms and governments. But amidst the disagreements, the anger, hatred and wars of this world's cities and nations, there is, and has always been, another greater city, the eternal city of God. And furthermore, in the middle of that city is our immovable God, who neither shakes, totters, nor falls, but offers us refuge and strength. Now, although the psalmist does not specifically mention Jerusalem, the city of God, does not really say Jerusalem, the people of that day would surely have connected the city of God, the holy habitation of the Most High, to the city of Jerusalem, which for them symbolized the center of their religious and spiritual life. And now, in spite of what verse 4 suggests, there is no river that runs through the city of Jerusalem, at least the earthly city of Jerusalem. But other biblical references help to explain how the Jewish people perceived what the psalmist was saying. The prophets Ezekiel, Joel, and Zechariah all speak of the waters of Jerusalem. Ezekiel 47 describes the river that flows from the temple. Joel 3:18 prophesies that in that day a fountain will flow out of the Lord's house. And Zechariah 13:1 speaks of a fountain that will be opened to the house of David to cleanse the inhabitants of Jerusalem from sin and impurity. But perhaps the clearest passage, which leaves no doubt as to where this river in the psalm originates, is found in the book of Revelation 22, verse 1. The river of the water of life, flowing from the throne of God, down the middle of the city of God. Unlike the waters of chaos, which were described in the first section of our psalm, we can rely on these waters in the eternal city from the throne of God to be eternally life-saving. Now finally, section 3 of Psalm 46 affirms God's plan for peace, not just for today, but for the future, for eternity. Now these days, it might not appear as if the world is on a trajectory for peace, but that is exactly what verses 8 and 9 invite us to see, that God instituted his plan for us at creation, that he has remained steadfast through it, through all history, and that he will bring that plan to fruition in his own good time. Verse 9 also makes it clear that his plan does not include wars, spears, bows, or shields. For that matter, neither does it include tanks, IEDs, or nuclear warheads. So just as Joyce Rupp realized on her Camino pilgrimage, our human tendency to compete with each other, criticize, create dissension, divide ourselves, leads to nothing but anxiety, fear, frustration, and exhaustion, none of which God wants for us. He offers us a better approach. Verse 10 clearly tells us that God's plan for us includes the following command: be still. Now, some biblical scholars advise that "be still" is perhaps not the best translation, as the Hebrew word used for it does not indicate passivity, nor should we envision it as a command to sit in our recliners, relaxing, being silent, and meditating. Rather, an alternate translation, which I prefer, is "cease your striving." In the world of Psalm 46, the original Hebrew would have meant stop, cease your efforts, throw down your weapons, depend on God rather than yourselves. Stop fighting because your God fights for you and he fights for peace. Cease striving from your own strength, because your God, your refuge, and your strength is striving on your behalf. And that is all that you need. But to cease our striving is also to choose. And choosing demands action. It asks us to respond to God. One of my seminary professors, Denise Hopkins, pointed out that to worship a God who ends war, breaks spears, and whose goal is peace requires us to live and act according to these same goals. God, who has been in control of this world since the beginning, asks of us that we work to help bring about his new heaven and new earth in an active way. And some of these ways are hard for us. Getting to know others who are not like us. Ascribing to the belief that relationships are not about us, versus them. Seeing God's world, including all God's created people, through new, more compassionate eyes. As with a pilgrimage, we can choose to walk by relying on our own feeble human resources, or we can choose to accept that God is the only very present daily help that we need. As one of my friends wisely observed, are we not all pilgrims on our journey? Are we not all, every one of us, a refugee? Because although we temporarily live in this world, we recognize that this world is not our home. And are we all not seeking safety and refuge? May we choose God to lead us step by step. From one safe place to the next. Because our God has told us that He is our only sure refuge and strength, and that He will be with us and for us as we journey through this world and into the next. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, help us to relax into your plan for us. Take from us the tension that makes peace impossible. Take from us the fears that prevent us from venturing out into your world to work for your kingdom. Take from us the worries that blind our sight and the distress that hides the joy that you consistently provide. Allow us the certainty that you are with us in our troubles. Amen and amen. Please stand for our song.
Conquered the grave.
faithful friends, go in peace. Do not be anxious. Do not worry. And do not strive. Cease your striving, because God is striving for you. And may the blessings of God the Father Almighty, His Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen.
Shine a light and let the whole world see. We're singing for the glory of the risen King. We're singing, shine a light and let the whole world see. Singing for the glory of the risen King. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation. He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave.